Going to introduce. So first of all, the people at home probably can't see, but Sarah Opie, who's our Director of Missions, Marketing and Comms, is over there. I'm going to pass over to Rebecca Desport in just a moment. Rebecca is our Chief Operating Officer, who's going to lead the update, and then we'll probably tag team in terms of responses on the finances. And for those of you, I'm sure you do know, but Phil Hardy is Head of 8 to 13, Antonia Clark, Head of 2 to 8, and Tracy Mounter, who's Pastoral Deputy at 13 to 18. Over to you.
Thank you. Morning, everyone. As Jeremy said, I'm Rebecca Desport. I'm the Chief Operating Officer here at St Peter's, and we'll get this bit over with first. It's the financial position. So I'll just run through the slide and then there'll be an opportunity for people to ask questions. So since the last parent meeting, we knew it was coming and it did. So VAT will be applied to all independent school fees from the 1st of January next year. We've lost the business rates relief. That costs this school around about £500,000 a year. And then the increase of NI contributions, that was a bit more of a surprise, another 1.2%. But with the threshold move, that cost the school about 2.5% more on salaries. So three things there that are really quite significant costs for the school, most of which we were expecting, but one of which was a lovely extra. As you should already know, hopefully, the school will absorb some of the impact of the VAT so that the increase felt by parents is 12% rather than the full 20%. And that's happening in the published fees. You've already got those from the 1st of January. And then obviously we're then looking at our operating model. We're looking at our cost base, taking into account the feedback from the parental value survey. So really trying to protect the things that parents told us are really, really important, but looking at the things that parents have told us are less important and trying to control our costs so that we can protect parents as best we can from the fee increases from the VAT, the full 20%. Fees for 25-26 will be published in Easter, which is our usual cycle. We'll publish them just before the Easter holidays, hopefully. And then that gives parents an opportunity to just think through what they want to do for the next year. So that's all I wanted to say from the slides, but I appreciate you might have some questions. Ooh. So I'll just repeat the question for the people back at home. So the question was, is the plan that we still continue to absorb 8% of the VAT increase in next year's fees? You're not going to particularly like the answer, but we haven't taken that decision yet. We have to work through how much cost can we continue to control. We will try as hard as we can to protect parents for as long as possible by looking at our cost base. We haven't quite completed that piece of work yet, which is why the fees will be published in Easter. Any other questions? So the question was, will deferring some of the capital works help us with reclaiming some of the VAT? Not particularly at this stage. So what you're referring to is the capital goods scheme. So you can recover VAT on capital. You have to spread it over 10 years from when you first built from when you first brought that building into use. So it doesn't really help the delay because we wouldn't have brought it into use before now anyway. So it doesn't really help with the VAT recovery.
And on the previous capital spend as well, so obviously we've invested quite a lot in the campus, so Pascal building, boathouse, for example, but the amount that you can reclaim back on an annual basis, and Rebecca, I think you've got the details on this, which I don't have, but you can't just go back and claim back in large sums the VAT spend previously.
No, so so for those of you who are very interested in the capital goods scheme, if you spent £10 million on a building 7 years ago, and that £2 million of that was VAT, You can divide the VAT portion by 10 because you can reclaim over 10 years. You can reclaim, therefore, £200,000 a year for the remaining 3 years out of the 10 that you've got. So it's not quite the windfall that the press have kind of implied it might be. It's helpful, of course it is, but the VAT bill for the school is around about £5 million. So a couple of hundred thousand, whilst helpful, isn't really a massive inroad into that, unfortunately. So the question was the VAT challenge for SEND children. Is there any time frame? I don't think there's any time frame for any legal challenge, particularly at all. I think obviously there are several challenges in the offing. We have to work on the assumption that those challenges will be unsuccessful. Unfortunately, if they are happily successful, then we will work with parents to rectify the situation through the billing. I think we have to all assume that, unfortunately, they will not be successful.
Yeah, it'll be a retrospective. So in terms of our external grouping, so obviously we stand as an independent school, which is great to have that flexibility. It's also great that we're in a number of different associations. So you've got the Independent Schools Council, and that's the umbrella hub for all independent schools. If you ever see somebody representing us in the media, it's likely to be a lady called Julie Robinson, who's a very old friend of mine, who's extremely good. She's the one who appears on the Sunday programmes, on the Radio 4 programme, and places like that. That grouping is then underneath that, you've got a variety of other groupings. So we, for example, are also in the Boarding Schools Association, the Independent Associated Preparatory Schools, and also HMC as well, which is the largest of all of the independent school organisations. So they've decided to come together and took a vote about a month or so ago to mount a legal challenge. So you've seen some individuals, families, saying they want to mount legal challenges. And then ISC, on behalf of the associations, is also preparing a legal case as well. So working with a very experienced person, so Lord Panic, who's leading for us on this one. The process there is that they have to gather. So they're gathering some examples of individual children and families who have been harmed by the policy. Because obviously, and sorry for the sucking eggs moment, but you have to have sort of actual, you can't just go for a conceptual challenge. You have to go and say, here are human beings who have been harmed by this, and then take that case forward there. I was down in London last week. I sit on the HMC National Council at the moment. I don't see that being a particularly rapid process. And as Rebecca said, the outcome is not certain either. It may be helpful just to say a few words about why we say that we'll be publishing the fees at Easter. So in terms of the cycle of that, so schools that have to operate in a slightly different pattern and cycle to other businesses, in the sense that, as with all businesses, you need to get a good sense of what's your income stream looking like, what's your expenditure line looking like. And for us, for the following academic year, that only really starts to emerge in the second half of the Easter term. Because the key drivers in there are things like the usual sort of inflationary costs on the business, so cost of goods and services, for example, decisions on the annual pay award for staff at the school as well. But also it's linked into the cycle of numbers in the school. So we've recently just completed our cycle for sixth form applications, and the offers went out yesterday morning to those families there. Their deadline is the middle of January to start to get them back in. So you start to get a growing picture as to what sixth form numbers will look like for next September. But we won't know about whether some children in current fifth form, their intentions. Sometimes you get an earlier look, but the deadlines, I'm sure you'll know, is a one term's notice. So in effect, it's not really until the Easter holidays, day one of the summer term, that you know exactly sort of the sense of that, not just for sixth form, but across the entire school. And then the deadline for applications for the other year group entry points is the end of December. We do the assessments in sort of middle of January, send out the offers around Valentine's Day, so half February, half term, and again, deadlines for acceptances. So the crucial picture of pupil number, which then relates into all the other variables about income and expenditure lines, means that we're not in a position to make a budget decision until about March time. And that's why it's linked in. The reason I mention that is that this is not a business, unfortunately, that can do any sort of form of dynamic pricing, for example. We've had to do a mid-year change because the government brought in VAT from the 1st of January. That was the reason behind that one. But typically, schools are unusual in having to set a budget in March, which you then think is going to work for you from the 1st of September through to the 31st of August of the following year. And it is one of those things which I'm afraid we're slightly hidebound by, but that's some of the realities of the cycle. Oh, there we go.
Thank you. Well, thank you all very much. I shall just go and stand over here and Jeremy will take you through the rest of it. Thank you.
I mean, and one of the things I think that Rebecca was emphasising, which I would like to emphasise, is that we do have a very strong, what we call the contingencies list. And that's everything from the sort of stuff that any business on a sort of a rotational cycle will look at its cost lines and ask itself some good questions about cost lines and what's going on. So some simple sort of stuff there through to sort of the things which would take even more cost out of the organisation. Here is the CEO this morning. I don't think you're going to hear an awful lot of the headmaster talking. So forgive me as I got my CEO hat firmly on. But looking at sort of what measures would the school do if we had to take other more significant costs out of the system? The guiding principle, and again, the reference back to the values survey, is wanting to preserve and protect the experience of pupils and parents. That's obviously the most important thing in terms of why families choose to have their children here at Peter's in the first place. And their experience and your experience is obviously the last thing that we want to sort of muck around with. That's why the value survey, as I say, was very helpful in terms of getting a sense of what do parents truly value. In case you're wondering, everything, which is so, and it's one of those factors, which is that because we've got this really strong vision of how do you produce amazing adults whilst having a brilliant time at school, because we feel that it is the combination of not just the academics, but it's the way we do the teaching and learning. That's a curiosity driven, engaging, collaborative approach. Why we think the co-curricular is so important, not just for healthiness and happiness and broad range of interests, but crucially the acquisition of skills and then also the pastoral structures in the school that gum it all together and make it all work. That's how we think is the best way to educate. And in a good way, we've seen that parents concur very heavily. The consequence of that is it's very difficult to look at some of these models. It doesn't mean you can't look at all of those elements and think, okay, but what could we do less of or do differently? But there is a slight challenge in there. Yeah. Yep.
So the question was around the overall financial impact of all of those three changes on the top of the. So yes, the total cost of VAT is about £5 million, of which obviously some of it has been passed on in the price. It's about £500,000 for the business rates relief and the changes in the salary legislation. So the NI, the change in the NI threshold and the minimum wage change is about another £500,000. Thanks.
It's tough. 100%. It is really, really tough. And that's where this balance of what could the school absorb. And so the decision, so we made that decision back in the full board meeting back in June. So we looked at things there. We were guesstimating on April the 1st as being the date for VAT to come on. Everybody, logically, the first of the following September would have been the most sensible time if they're going to bring in such an enormous change into it. We all know, by the way, that HMRC won't be, and this is with love to HMRC, don't often send them love, but with love to them, there's no way that they can be actually ready to really clearly have it all already in place for the 1st of January. So, in the simple housekeeping way, we're being advised to keep all of our receipts. So I'm imagining lots of shoeboxes across in the bursary. So it is a real challenge, but we made that decision back in June. That we thought, looking at the sort of the budget cycle for this academic year, that was the flex that we could put in. But it's that combination of we're trying to look after, as you always do, but it's just in a more heightened way. I always say when you set a budget, you're trying to look after the children in terms of the offering that you give to them. You're trying to look after the parents in terms of the fees that you're asking them to pay. And you're trying to look after your colleagues in terms of remunerating them effectively for what they do. So that's always been the triangle that you're trying to balance through. And it's, as by definition, simply far more challenging than it has been previously. Yeah. Other questions? Yeah. So the question is how are we covering the shortfall? I'll just very briefly, because I think it was covered earlier on, this is going to be recorded, I think, and going to be available later on. But in essence, that's where we look at the cost base of the organisation, and you're looking at the contingencies, and you're looking at what you can actually take out in terms of cost. There's a slightly more positive side, which we haven't mentioned yet, which is revenue away from school fees. as well. And that's a DAR that we've been pushing on for about the last 5 years or so. Well, we've always had it because there's always been things like external lettings at the school. But this is things like our school across in Hainan, for example. This figure has been published before, so I'm very happy to say it's a flat income, a minimum of £240,000 a year. That's our management fee, and that has to reach our bank account net of all costs. So you've got Hainan, yeah. So you've got about £250,000 there. And at any one time, I was meeting with some potential partners overseas a couple of weeks ago, had an email from them back end of last week. I mean, I won't just sort of go through in details these, but you know, there are other overseas opportunities that we continue to explore as well. Looking to increase the external lettings side of things. We do think about nurseries, for example. We've got, you know, a national brand, inverted commas, for the quality of our early years education. So it's not just about trying to hive back and hive back. It's also looking at where can you generate other revenue as well. Okay, all right. Well, let's move on to. Just moving on to the campus master plan. So just in a way, this ties into the two school model in the sense that we made that decision to rephase and not put the brakes on or stop or pause or anything like that, but to rephase the move towards the two school model. Not because suddenly we realised VAT was coming. We've been modelling for that for 2 years, so that wasn't a surprise. One of the real kickers behind deciding to rephase was it was linked into getting the tenders back in for the first major works of the project. And so the first of two major works was the enlargement and massive improvements that were needed very heavily anyway in the dining room at 13 to 18. And then as you go over the bridge down towards Olives, down towards 8 to 13, the rather ugly building in front of you, that building is pretty much towards the end of its lifespan as a building. And the word cladding is an awkward word, but that's the technical architectural term. That's what that building needs. It needs completely recladding to make it a really sort of fit and effective building going forwards. The dining room project came back in above and actually slightly above the contingencies, because you always put in that headroom into those sort of things. The cladding project down there came in massively way over. One of the challenges that they gave to us was that when you try and do things within an 8-week summer holiday window and doing it intensively, they wanted to de-risk heavily. And by that, I mean, they wanted to put in a massive sort of cost base into it to say, you know, we might need to want to just flood the place with workers, we want to do this, that and the other. And it was just not going to be prudent to plow ahead last summer holidays with getting that incredibly expensive piece of work done, given that we'd always factored in there was a risk element to it because of VAT and what impact might that have on pupil number and therefore upon income. So we'd already factored that one in. But it would have been just made no business sense whatsoever to have blindly carried on with such an increased bill. And if the first two major projects were coming in set that much over, what might be happening further down the track? So that was the driver that led us to decide to rephase the project and push that horizon time back to do it by 2027. There's a neat coincidence around the anniversary, but there's not really a particular driver for that one. But that was the logic behind it. So one of the great benefits of having made that decision is that it's actually enabled us to have a Gantt chart, which actually has work that goes on throughout term times as well. So what we're able to do is we're able to do effectively a Rubik's Cube approach to things and start to decant things. So the first couple of things that you can visibly see are, and if you haven't, do go and visit in an entirely visitor badge safeguarding correct way, do go and have a look at the dining room. It is a stunning facility and also does have a commercial element because now it's a sort of venue that we could externally let for dinners and functions and things like that. The second one has been Burton Cottage. That's the property next door to the library, which has been converted into the most incredibly stunning, amazing medical and well-being centre. And that's enabled us to really sort of, first of all, you probably know, we put a massive push on mental health in the last few years in any case, but it's enabled us to really visibly tie in physical health and mental health all in one place. It's a brilliant environment for it. It's used by hundreds of children across the span of any weeks, which is amazing. Yes. So very brief, the question is about the mental health, whether they get access or be invited. It works, it's entirely free-flowing. So children can self-refer, and we've been doing that. So the Wellbeing Centre has been across, some of you will know, as the Windy Tunnel as you go across towards Pascal. And increasingly what we found is that more and more children just taking themselves across the Wellbeing Centre, but also there's a referral process. as well. So that's an amazing facility. Pardon me. For those of you who may not be aware, the medical centre for the senior school has been located on the floor above where my study is as you come into the school. A tremendous place if you've got a bust ankle, by the way, trying to get through the school and up some stairs and so forth. So they're out from there. I've got noisy neighbours in at the moment, so repurposing it, and then delightful neighbours such as the marketing, admissions and comms team, and also HR, which currently is in the bottom half of the pavilion. They move and become my nice neighbours upstairs. I've got a broom in case I need to bang on the ceiling. And then what that means is once they're up inside there, then it means that the alumni team will move across towards where the admissions and marketing team are at the moment. HR moves above where I am. Across the course of this summer holidays, we've got a fantastic refurbishment, repurposing of the ground floor of the pavilion into not just badly needed better changing facilities and a hospitality centre, but also a multi-function space, which again, we can use for meetings, but also can be used for external lettings as a conference venue and things like that as well. So that's the pattern that we're following. I appreciate there may not be many boarding families in the room. There might be some online, but just to update or reminder rather than to update. Coming September, that's part of the move towards the two school model. So at the moment, we have Wentworth, which has boarders in J4 and J5, and then four boarding houses from third form through to upper sixth, two boys and two girls. So from September, we're going to have four boarding houses. Two sixth form ones, so Dronfield and Manor, the ones just over the other side of the bridge for sixth form boys in Manor and girls in Dronfield, and then 11 to 16 or J4 to fifth form, Linton for boys and The Rise for girls. That fits into the fact that boarding at the school has been running on an 11 to 18 basis for a long time. In any case, it matches the national picture of boarding, which is 50% of all boarders in the country are sixth form boarders. And fewer than 4% of boarders in the country are below the age of 12. And that's exactly what we've seen in our own school. So it fits in neatly to the pattern that we've got. It also means that we can provide a much more bespoke sort of sixth form boarding. Sixth form applications has become a really popular point for the school. So again, sorry to get back to my CEO hat, but you've got the educational side, the pastoral side, commercially, in terms of making it a really attractive point at which to join Peters and to become a boarder for sixth form, for example. And then likewise, by consolidating the other boarding into the two houses, by definition, you've instantly doubled the size of the year groups. So it creates a better community and atmosphere, which again, makes it more attractive. So that's a sort of move for September. That frees up Wentworth. And in the master plan for the whole two school thing, that's going to be for sixth form taught only subjects. So business, politics, economics, history of art and so forth. And then when the junior school moves down to there, this is going to be, folks at home, I'm pointing it at 228, the Chilman building. This is going to be an amazing sixth form centre. So what it means is that over the course of this summer, with Wentworth sort of there, we can then start to bring across the sixth form only subjects across to here. That then creates space in the middle of the school over there. We can start to move some of the pastoral space around. I'll leave it there, but you can sort of imagine then the Gantt chart going forward. One of the great things about it, as I say, is it enables us to phase the cost out over a longer period of time. The cost of all of it is significantly reduced and significantly cheaper because we're not having to compress it into 8 weeks. We can use our own teams increase for what we're doing as well. So it makes an enormous amount of sense. Slightly less disruption in many ways in terms of going, and we're going to suddenly do a massive change and then move across into a new setting. The other thing about it is it's got the slight element of what's, you know, sometimes people refer to as the collapsing paper bag element to it, which is that every single component part makes the school better in its current configuration. So if anything, I don't want to have to be standing up in front of people saying, I'm so sorry that I'm talking about another rephasing. But if the last 5 years has taught the world anything, it's always wise to just have what are some of your broader contingencies. So it's quite a nice sort of flexible approach. Yeah. So the question is, how do you operate running a school alongside sort of the noise and so forth? A really simple example I could give would be the Pascal building. So that entire building site, so when I first sort of was coming and looking at the school, that was all sort of hived off behind Harris fencing and things. And there was a full massive drop down an enormous teaching block that was there and putting up another enormous teaching block. So in terms of that, it's exactly that. It's about being able to hive off spaces and looking at it. And I'm relaxed about that. And I'm partially relaxed because on our operations team, so Giles Roberts, our director of operations, and all of his teams are teams that have got amazing track records of delivering really significant projects alongside the school getting on with it as well. Yes, question from... Yeah, so you may be aware about the AstroTurf and the access road. So what we're doing at the moment is we're just preparing to resubmit our application. Forgive me for those of you who know heard this before. I'll keep talking quickly if that's all right. If as long as I'm not going too quickly, then plan is to get as much in as possible. So in essence, we were working through. So every time you put a planning application for something like that, especially in the great city of York, you're going to be dealing with the Environment Agency on flood questions and things like that as well. So all those sorts of things. So we're working through with Sport England and some of their questions about were we going to be losing a cricket pitch, for example, and what that might mean, working with the Environment Agency, et cetera, et cetera. Three bat surveys, or was it four? I think we're on to number four by now. So the darling pipistrelles apparently, and unsurprisingly, quite like using rivers as navigation routes rather than flying randomly across open land. But there we go. We've done that three times. So we know that to be the case. So we were working through. We felt very well and effectively sort of with all the questions and challenges. And quite right, don't have a problem with it. It's always good to have challenge. We then suddenly got two bits of information. One was that we were told that in 10 days' time, this is going to a final planning decision committee for a yes, no answer. So that was quite tight in itself. Then the second thing that happened was all of a sudden on the website, we got suddenly a huge number of new questions and challenges within 10 days to go. I'm not a cynic, so I don't think there's any coincidence between those two points. What it did mean was there was no way on earth that we were going to, within 10 days, work through all of those objections. And as all of you know, the last thing you want to do is to put something in for planning, which you know cannot be given a green light. And so hence why we withdrew the application and we're now working on a resubmission, taking into account some of the questions and challenges. You know, the AstroTurf is a massive priority because of sports space for the school. The access road would bring enormous benefits. It would take pressure off Queen Anne's Road. It would take pressure off the avenue because it would have flowing traffic going down through there as well. In terms of being able to get fire appliances down to the school and everything else, we know that it would make a massive difference. So we're just working with the planning office at the moment as well, just to try and gauge and work out what's going to be the most successful way to put an application in, whether that's a job lot or chunked or whatever it might be. Recent frustration for us was that back in May, I think we submitted for floodlights for the existing AstroTurf, and that has sort of drifted on, and they kept on me to, oh, you know, it's all fine, it's all satisfying everything, and then it turns out that the junior underling in the department hadn't actually really been presenting it to the senior overling, and it's all of a sudden it just got deferred. Oh, could we defer that for another month, another 2 months, and so forth? And so, incredibly frustrating process, because we're advised that the floodlight plan that we've got is absolutely bang on. So for those of you who are geeks on this sort of stuff, sorry if you are, don't take that as an offence. You are, I put myself in as chief geek on all this stuff because I kind of love this stuff. So I've shown a drawing plan as to what would be the lumens, what would be the light leakage from the planned floodlights. The answer is, by the time you got to 3 to 5 meters outside of the AstroTurf, you'd be down to about 3 lumens, or to put it another way, it's basically contained within a nice rectangular shape. Glance over the river at the Railway Museum, you see a very different form of light pollution. So what do we have at the moment? We have temporary floodlights in place, which is helpful in the winter months, which of course are angling up and causing issues. So we'd be very super grateful if we could just get that one over the line. I'm just checking that I'm not sort of getting towards the end of term, either slightly too mischievous or potentially slightly bolshy and prickly. Okay. Yes. Yeah, the question is, which planning consultants are we using? We can get you the question offline. I think I know, but then sometimes when headmasters very confidently think they know things, turns out they've just got the wrong idea. Okay. I mean, one thing I would say, sorry, welcome to the day program. What I would say is, what I would say is that we've got a number of groups that we work with. We work with different architects, we work with different planning consultants. And one of the things that we're very fortunate at, especially being based here in York and the region, is a lot of people who really get some of the, I don't know whether it's Kafkaesque, Byzantine or Orwellian approaches to planning. But we have some very experienced people that we work with. Yeah. Yeah, there's a question about is a plan for getting neighbours more on board. It's tricky, if I'm really honest, because we value our neighbours enormously. We understand, you know, completely get why people would have concerns about living on Westminster Road and the Avenue, for example. So completely get it. The difficulty that we've got is that if the view is we just simply don't want this full stop, and the school's perspective is, but we need this for not just for the school, but actually there's nowhere in York which has got two AstroTurf side by side. The city is massively low on AstroTurf facilities in particular, and there's a sort of a real pressing need for it. And I think that the school is fundamentally a force for good in York. I mean, one way to look at us is we contribute £90 million a year directly into the local economy through salaries, goods and services. And we do an enormous amount of partnership work that we do get benefit from. It makes us better as an educational organisation, but we don't do that to tick any boxes with the government, for example. So you've got that side to it. We employ about 350 to 400 people locally. So we can't hide or change the fact that we are an organisation of the size that we are. And what we do is we educate children, but we also provide amazing resources and facilities for the area. So that's the bit that's really tricky in terms of trying to get the neighbours on side, in inverted commas. Because if the neighbours' perspective is, look, fundamentally, I hear what you're saying, Mr. Walker, but at base and at heart, we just really don't want this. No, I'm sorry, I'm talking to you as though you are, but does that? Yeah, no, for sure, and I totally get it. I totally get where people are coming from, and I do have respect for it. I do understand it, but at the same time, you know, with some of this, the only way to do it would be to say, well, all right, we simply won't plan to do anything like this at all, and that's where the nexus point comes in. Trying to have good communication, trying to be open, trying to sort of to demonstrate what the school offers, you know, all of those sorts of things. We have actually looked at, so for example, as you go down Westminster Road, the little footpath down to the riverside is the one with all the routes that bust through the tarmac and things. You know, we've looked at part of the development. One of the things we could do would be to, on our side, put in a really good broad lit cycle path that would get people down to the riverside. So there are ways that we sort of think, what can we do as part of the project that might actually bring some tangible benefit as well? Okay. Right. I think that's it's a segue across to. It's working. So could you advance the next? Sorry. It's not working. Oh, is it there? Sorry. Like I say, headmaster's demonstrating they're really super good at some things and then tripped over by the simple stuff. Oh. I will talk to it. It's fine. It was only going to be just a few sort of bullet points as a bit of a slight visual aid. So in terms of the two school model, what we're obviously working on is not just waiting until the magical moment when the physical side is in place and then make the move. We've actually been working for the last 5 to 6 years on trying to improve the flow of education as a priority for the school. So looking at what it feels like to go from year three into J1, what it looks like to go to J4, J5, into third form, into you know, oh, bless you. Thank you very much. So yeah, the campus work is obviously a major enabler, but we've actually been working on areas that we can bring forwards already in terms of getting a much better flow of experience. One of the great benefits of Phil's move from being head of 2 to 8 to being head of 8 to 13 is being able to start to bring in a lot more sense of flow and commonality between the experience that children and families have here. And I think that's starting to manifest itself already. And I'm very grateful to Phil for the incredible work he's doing in that area. So looking at that sort of things, and also just trying to look at the flow. So in a very small way, we did some first time we've done some sort of taster days last Saturday. School was super busy, had lots of people here doing different things, but people experiencing, giving them a better understanding of what life is like over there, coming into nursery and reception. And we also had a couple of the classes of J5 were up in the senior school on that Saturday morning. And we've got some more of those planned in January. So when senior school's in mocks, in trials, them getting some come up, spending more time with the teachers. We've been overlapping the teaching staff more this year than we have previously. So what that means is some colleagues who are trained and have previously taught all the way up to A level, but are currently sort of, you know, their main location has been at 8 to 13, now starting to teach through into the senior school as well. And we've always had in the languages and in classics, senior school teachers teaching some of the J4, J5 classes. So a bit more there. So we're deliberately starting to overlap more on teaching staff as we go across there. And so what we're doing at the moment is, so we've had a variety of whole school leadership. So we have, you've got myself and Rebecca and Sarah and Phil and Antonia sort of in terms of the what's called the SBLT. That's the top sort of grouping there. Each section has their own leadership team. So Phil has his 8 to 13, Antonia 2 to 8 and at 13 to 18. So we also use that sometimes as like a stickle bricks approach. So getting all of those people together and then doing workflows and things. So we've been working, we've had sort of 2 to 3 meetings this term of those groupings where just asking people to come forward with proposals as to areas of the academic, the pastoral and the co-curricular that we can start to blend across more. And one of the projects inside there, for example, would be looking at the schemes of work that they do across J4, J5 and third form, or to put it in other terms, year 7, 8, 9, key stage 3. Now, we don't follow the national curriculum, but those chunks are really useful ways to look at things. Also, 11 plus is a massively significant and important entrance point to the school. So having the best possible 7, 8, 9 flow of curriculum as they come through. So at the moment, there's tremendous harmony and has been for generations between the departments at 8 to 13 Olives and Peter's 13 to 18, but wanting to make it much more sort of formalised around having unified schemes of work that look at the flow of the content, the flows of the skills acquisition. We've done some really simple stuff on this. We've spent some time with our colleagues from 13 to 18, spent time with colleagues at 8 to 13 on some of the really core simple stuff. What are the children used to in J5 in terms of patterns of homework, patterns of prep, you know, how classes are organised and so forth. So, you know, where do they sort of find resources? So trying to make sure that they all have that better flow. And again, to do the Mission Impossible, peel the mask off and show you the CEO again, having the best possible offering for years 7 and 8 is a crucial driver for the school as well. The 13 plus standalone prep school scene has obviously diminished enormously over the years. The 11 plus scene is massively important as an entrance point for us. So making that as attractive and exciting and as distinctive as possible. So we've been working for the last 3-4 years on sixth form and really think about not just the last 2 years at school in different clothing, but actually what's the sixth form offering and what's distinctive about it. And a very similar thought then, what's really distinctive about joining into Peter's in year 7 and 8, you know, if you are going to be physically located in that section of school, but you're not actually being held back in a junior school setting, those sorts of things. So those are some of the things. And we're just, as we come towards the end of a term, and again, going back to the cycles of schools, so much of our work on these sort of areas is massively collaborative project work. So one of the things at my leadership meetings yesterday, and again, bad luck to all of you lot, is today, is just a massive checklist of about 6 or 7 big projects that we're working on, just to get sort of state of the nation on all of them. Because as we go into the end of the Easter and end of the Christmas term, it will have to be put on a shelf for about 3 weeks. So just checking that where we are with all those projects. So that's sort of some of the flow that's going on there with the two school thing. Yeah. The Minster's all right, because the Minster has now completely lifted their cap on numbers. So just going back to sort of some of that sort of stuff. So we were held back by the Minster as to how many we could have in. I was in the Minster on Sunday afternoon, the most delightful darkness like Advent Carol service. There must have been about 1,500 people in there, every single one of them holding a candle throughout the entirety of it, including a colleague's daughter who's in year 3 here. So the Minster's in a good place as far as I'm concerned. Minster stuff is much, much easier for us. The move across into having to, so for those of you who don't know, Chapel has a fixed capacity. The Mem Hall has a fixed capacity as well. We'd already actually reached the point where in the Mem Hall, the upper sixth was sort of sitting on the stairs coming down the middle of through the bleachers. So we're already quite crowded there. So what we do is we now extract out one house from Chapel each time we have a chapel. There's actually been a benefit to that because it's given us additional pastoral and tutor time and house time. So there's actually been a win out of that one. With regard to assemblies, they're live streamed. And so the chapel, the house that's out each week on a rotation for that still gets the experience, except they get it in the wonderful dining room on a big screen with some croissant, rather than having to sit and listen to me and pay attention. So that's sort of some of the ways of doing that one. Yes. Sure. So numbers are Sure. So numbers in the sixth form is about 140 to 145 per year group. So J4, J5, so year 7 and 8 is about 100, 105, somewhere around there. Coming up into year 9, into third form, it's about 100, 110 or so, 110, maybe up to 115. Fourth and fifth form, so year 10 and 11, is 115 to 120. So those, and those, in the full growth plan, so at the moment, we've got 1,330 in the entire school. And in the full growth plan, we forecasted around, or budget, you know, looking at campus works, around 1,385. So we're actually very, very close to what we would say is the natural maximum cap. And that again, it gets into trying to get the balance between, you know, the school has been very fortunate. People, you know, people always have things that they don't think is quite right at the school, or things they wish were different or better, whatever it might be. But we are genuinely fortunate that people overwhelmingly seem to have a strong regard for the school. That's manifested itself in, over recent years, quite a significant increase of applications to the school, with various economic challenges and so forth. Being able to expand the pupil number has been a good thing for the school. And in terms of class sizes, at sixth form, class sizes have risen from an average of about 9, 10, 11 to 11, 12, 13. So it's been a very minimal increase. And actually, because we've been able to manage the growth by keeping the same standards and criteria for entrance, so one of our decisions, by the way, is not to drop that bar. It means that we've actually just got really just good buzzy classes with two to three more people in, which actually at sixth form is really great for discussion. So the growth plan that we've been on has been very considered. It's been based around maintaining experience for the children, mitigating issues around sort of, you know, numbers in chapel and assembly and so forth, but looking at what the benefit is, actually can be benefit for the children as well as obviously from a business perspective. So ultimately, when we move to the junior school, it's quite an important one to repeat. So are there any plans for changes to Saturday school? Sorry, thank you, Sarah. So ultimately, when we move to the junior school, senior school model, the plan would be that the junior school would be on a 5-day week basis. So what's currently J1, J2, J3, so would be on a 5-day basis. And then year 7 upwards would be year 7 and 8 would have Saturday morning lessons only, and then be finished at lunchtime. So replicating effectively the J4, J5 piece, and then 13 plus, exactly. And there are no plans to draw back on when they get to the 13 plus age range of the school, of drawing back from the full 6-day a week process. And the logic for that has always been the same. So forgive me if you're entering karaoke sing along here, but you're going to have to take wagons off the back of the train. It's never going to be the academic wagons. So what we'd be taking away is the wider co-curricular piece, the time for pastoral and tutorial, and all those sort of things. So there's no plans for the much older children to move back from there. What we'd like to do is we'd like to address the issue of sustainability and energy levels of the year 4s and the year 5s and the year 6. So one thing I would say is that as part of our planning work this term, we've been challenging ourselves to say, is it possible to make an adjustment to Saturday mornings before we get to the full 2-school model? And it is really very challenging in terms of timetabling structures. We currently have a geographical split amongst the school. And although we've got more and more overlapping of staff between sections of the school, it is extraordinarily complex to do that. And so I also know that there are some people who would be very keen for us to push towards that as soon as we possibly can. We also have some families who really value it and actually would rather keep it. So it's one of those classics, you're never gonna keep everybody happy on it. But what I would say is, Radio 4 again, sorry, I wouldn't want to set any hairs running or set up any too many hopes and expectations about next September. And, you know, hopefully a straight answer as best as I can give. Yeah, that's all right.
stage, I feel like in the dark.
But yeah.
I appreciate there's a lot going on behind the scenes, but I would love just a bit more.
Yeah. Completely get it, and I know that my colleagues would appreciate the same as well. It is we're trying to come up, Phil. We're trying to do this really, really well in complex, changing times and all the rest of it. But at the same time, being really aware that what human beings want is some certainty and a direction of travel. Just in some ways, even if it's not like Saturdays, for example, not exactly what you'd like, but just some sense of okay, fine, cool. If that's the case, then when I talk to my child, how do I want to, exactly that sort of thing? So, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Philip Hardy, Phil, do you want to come and stand near the microphone? Nice, thank you.
On TV as well. Last year we introduced lots more welcome evenings I think it was just before Easter. I think we did the first one, didn't? Is that right? Yeah, that's right. Yeah, and then we think we had two in the summer term as well. So that would just be an for me to just talk about the things that you possibly see around the place, the changes. We are looking at smoothing the year three and year four curriculum, so it's very, very similar. So they actually have similarities within, you know, how they teach. Teaching year three, a thematic curriculum, and having the best parts of that into year four. We're looking at maybe in year five and six some sort of project-led learning as well as the discrete subjects as well. So we're looking at lots of different curriculums around that for the junior school, but also there's elements that we can actually introduce into the school now. So there's a few things. The other thing is, on a Saturday morning, I'm more than happy if there's a small, I did it last year a few times, if there's a small group of people want to come around on a Saturday morning, I can show you around on a Saturday. It's usually a quieter day, particularly in my diary, but where I can show you around the school and you can show you the it is not a scary place, I promise you. And it's because it's over there. And the more people have been around and had a look around, you'll see that actually it's a very welcoming place. And you'll see last year's year three just settling really well. And I've got to say this the year threes going to year four this year, the J1s have settled, and this is not just me saying this because it's obviously my first year really of seeing the transition, the full transition. They have really, really enjoyed it, and the staff are saying that they've settled in incredibly well. Some of that is still got that recognition of who I am, but also that there's been the change of a few staffing in J1 and J2, which has helped that transition. So, but there's an open invitation if you want to just contact the office at 8:13 and we show you around on a Saturday morning, more than happy to do so.
Thanks, Phil. That's brilliant. I think it's just one of the realities of the geographical setup of the school. Obviously, the Rubik's Cube, Olives used to be here. It used to be in this building before we then took on the Queen Anne's Grammar School and Olives moved down there. Miss Millibees and things and the Clifton sort of nursery and pre-book came across onto this side. And one of the slight curiosities, I quite like it that you've got the very youngest in the school are in proximity to the very oldest. It's actually brings quite a nice, lovely sort of a feel and atmosphere to it. The downside is that you have sort of 5 years where you're here next door to there. So you've got 10 years worth of education and then 5 years worth of education, sort of metaphorically, behind the trees and over the bridge, and you just don't see it. And in the same way, for those 5 years when families are there, they're more likely, sort of, you know, naturally, to be going down to there and then going away from there. So it's one of the features of the site that we just lose that connectivity of all three sections of the school. It's one of the things which, you know, ultimately, having a junior school and a senior school, the last thing I want is to then have the Balkan states. You know, so you've got sort of just two large lumps. I would never want that to happen at all, but it will help with the flow, like you want to come in.
Wall bars and all of that sort of thing. We've made it into a dance studio. We've put soundproofing in the ceiling, and it's a fantastic space for dance and yoga and gymnastics. And also, we've started some of the classroom design. We've started testing to change it to make it feel a lot more natural products, and very similar to the feel at 228. So we've started to build in that process as well with the architects, and also moving forward into the two school model, it would have a really lovely feel like it has here. So that's our plans, and we've started doing that already. And if you, again, I'll show you around when you come around on Saturday.
Okay, and as I mentioned, it's one of the great benefits of Phil, obviously, having been so immersed in this section of the school and now starting to be sort of driving change there as well. Just with a few minutes left. Oh, sorry, there's a question online. Yes, sir. Yep. I have got nothing against psychology A-level, and I don't mean that. For those of you who remember the old Peter... I know. Let me explain why it would be a big draw. It's all right. I was just about to refer to. If you remember that old gag with Peter Cook and Adam Moore, he's got Mr. Spigot with one. I've got nothing against you, your left leg. The problem is neither of you. So basically, it's a really fascinating one. So psychology is the third or fourth largest entrance subject at A level across the entire country. Without question, I reckon it would go into the top of the hit parade. Not necessarily top of, you know, number one. It would be massively popular without any question at all. In terms of psychology, pupils' expectations, pupils' experience and reality, it's obviously a lot more science-based and so forth than people sometimes imagine. It's a bit like PE. It's actually got very high levels of physiology and so forth going on there. So occasionally, for some children, it's not actually the subject which they necessarily think it is. It doesn't stop teenagers loving it, by the way. So at the moment, we really encourage people thinking about psychology to be thinking about more about a science-based route, so biology and chemistry. That's what those universities are looking for. Doesn't mean that there wouldn't be dozens of children who would love to just do it for 2 years as part of their A-level suite and program. At the moment, it comes up in RS, for example, in philosophy and ethics and so forth there. They can write an EPQ on it. So that's where we are. I have got a couple of colleagues who are very experienced trained psychology teachers doing completely different career path things at the moment. So I've got the potential to look at sort of building it in alongside. Here's the really interesting one. It gets back to headmaster over here and CEO over here. At the moment, sometimes when children say that they'd like to go to York College, for example, one of the reasons, you can never be quite sure, is it purely educational or for other reasons to go to York College, is because they can do psychology there. Sarah will have people looking to come and join sixth form who sometimes say, oh, I really want to come and do psychology. So you've got an interesting question mark inside there. If you were to put in psychology as a new subject, then you're loading cost into the system, and you're not going to make any cost savings anywhere at all, because we're not going to close a subject to bring in psychology. So you're just going to see other subjects with slightly fewer numbers in their classes because they've now got psychology. So there's a really interesting question. You've got an educational side. So headmaster hat says, I want the children to have this opportunity. I'd love them to be able to do it. And then you've got the CEO hat, which is just saying, I need to try and balance that with what does it mean in terms of ironing?
Less than just the traditional.
Yeah, the question is, would it make Sir Peter's more attractive and less traditional? If I have a world and space and time and all that, whatever that poem goes, then no problem at all. But I'm living in a world where cost pressures on the organisation are huge and massive. And so there's some balances. Now, I'm not built to be complacent. But looking at hard facts, we've grown the sixth form from about 120 to 145. The max we wanted to get to was 150. And we've done that without psychology. So I'm not saying, forgive me, just be aware, these are just portions of my brain. It's not like a fixed brain that says that's where I'm at. But constantly what I'm having to do with my colleagues is balance and try and think about, okay, on the plus side, I've got this one. But then on the other hand, I've got that one. It's the old tugging of a strand thing. I'm going to close the question down, if that's all right. I'm happy to talk afterwards. I'm running out of time. That would do basically create the same sort of issue, just in a smaller way. So we've got a very limited amount of time. I'm going to give you just a really quick run through this, partially because I sent a letter back to this. We've got a parents group who sent through a letter with lots of questions about mobile phones. I sent a letter back, which I don't believe has been fully shared on the WhatsApp group. I think people can ask to see it. If anybody would like to see a copy of that letter, just drop me an email. I'm very happy to share that letter. It was written to go to any parents at all who would just like to get an understanding as to where we are. So just terribly briefly before, as I say, forgive me, I'm going to have to dash. But in essence, we've already banned smartphones, increased the banning of smartphones by our own choice. And that's up until the end of year eight in Oliver. So we've done that. The direction of travel I'd like to take it in is to be able to extend the restrictions on smartphone use into the older year groups. I'm not going to stand in front of you and say, and what's the oldest year group I see myself extending it to? I might find that I want to look at third form first and then see how that beds in and goes forward, because we have now got year groups coming up into senior school who already are used to not having smartphones at school. So we've got the opportunity to continue that. At the moment, they have very small portions of the day when they could be on them. We might take an hour and 20 minutes for lunch. The reality is, for most children, they do not have an hour and 20 minutes of dead time, because not only are they eating, but there's a huge amount of the co-curricular stuff that's going on in that space. So a very simple example, every week, 160 children are singing the school choir on lunchtime. So we've got orchestras, we've got sports practices. So across that lunchtime, there is some time at which they can access it. A break time is a bare 20 minutes, but you finish the lessons at 11 o'clock and then you start again at 11:20. So we do have these small portions of time when they can be on their smartphones. Would I like to reduce it? Absolutely. For all the obvious reasons. I think it's worth saying that that's a portion within a portion of their day, within a portion of their year as well. So where it is for us is that at the moment, it says they're contingent on the one-to-one device approach. One of the great things we brought out of COVID and lockdown was Teams and Socks as being a fantastic way. Now, when you've got younger children, they don't need to be communicating digitally. The older children get, the benefits of being able to have fast, rapid communication is massive. And so for Teams, for teaching purposes and messages going around, pastoral purposes, tutors and house parents sending the messages on Teams, it's a really fast, efficient, effective way of good communication in the school. And if we just simply took that away, we would actually suffer as a consequence of doing it. We'd become much more clunky. That's why the two things are linked in. So just yesterday, I was up in Pascal playing around with, we've got 12 different devices, which different companies have sent through, different types of, you know, the ones that you can flip over the screen and straight laptops and stuff. So we're just working through at the moment this project to bring in a one-to-one device. And for pupils in the school, we're never going to become a screen intensive school. At the moment, in terms of the bell curve, we're way, way at the other end of the bell curve. So actually probably not yet giving them the fault of how you grow up in later life and you just get used to, you know, as we all do, pen and paper and screen and how you sort of get the balance between the two. So working through that project to get in, it's obviously got sort of financial structures that we need to bring in, sort of lease, probably a lease-based approach to doing it, having to work that one through. Infrastructure in school, charging points, what happens if the screen gets cracked in the course for a day, whatever it might be. So that's why, and again, going back to the cycle of school, September to September. So that's why we're looking to then bring it forward in next September. That's the point at which we can then start to put restrictions in. At the moment, there are some families and they already do things like, for example, they use the controls so their children cannot access certain apps during the course of the day. That's there and can be done by parents if they choose to do so. And I personally would support any parent who wants to do that. Likewise, you know, limiting how much time they can actually use their phone. There's the time limit thing as well. Again, totally support any parent who'd like to do that as well. When we bring it forward, at the moment in Phil's section of the school, they come in the front office, they put their mobile phones into the boxes, they collect them at the end of the day. We don't operate in quite that sort of in and out at the same time and through the same portals. But when we were flying out to Munich to go and do some work, a friend of mine dropped me a note and said, there's a school I used to work at, they've got these wonderful little magnetic bags. So the child has this phone, but it has to be in the magnetic bag, which they can't prise open. But there are magnetic points dotted around the school, and the school says at 4 o'clock, for example, or 3:30, whatever sort of time you want to do. Then, and only then, can they tap their bag against the thing to be able to extract their phone. So that for me was brilliant news, because it was a really simple, practical answer to the question of, if you choose to ban them, how can you try and say, I never want to see a phone, even in your inside pocket, claiming you're not going to use it. And at the moment, we choose not to issue an order, an instruction that you can't police. You know, children, pets, everything. Never issue an instruction to a dog, and especially in the park when you're walking it, you know, come back if it's not going to come back. And at the moment, we think it would be logistically impractical to have either, there's two options of this one in the house rooms. One is CCTV surveillance in every single room, which is not a good look for lots of reasons. And the second one would be virtually constant patrolling, which again, we don't think is practical. So we're not in an ideal situation with it. It's less prevalent than it might sometimes appear to be, but we do have a plan for solving it. Yeah. Oh, yes.
just say on the WhatsApp. I might have missed that, but how do we then get access to the WhatsApp group? So, well, it was just an informal thing of set up, and it's just grown really through to principally age 13 year group WhatsApp, so to make anybody who's interested. Certainly
send
you a link and then
it's
your
opportunity as well.
So
I've got both. Conversation about how to join the WhatsApp group and so forth. So Yeah, it's a very helpful question. It's to do with about how we can make sure that we've got the understand the voice parents. So there's 140 members, I think, on the WhatsApp group, something that's a number. So it's a decent number in terms of being able to give a slice into these other views of some. And I'm sure, like all groups, there won't be everybody in exactly the same perspective on it. But again, it's just people who have an interest in this topic area. So I wasn't going to mention the irony, but yeah, I completely get it. Yeah. Yes. So I'm literally going to have to go because the third form would be lining up outside the classroom. But the question is, I think that the general topic theme is good communication between home and school and good interaction. I think that's and I would say, and please don't interpret anything I've said as being sort of, you know, prickly or anything at all about the group and the things. Just looking for good ways to communicate and things. And hence why, so we're looking to have a meeting with the representatives in January. To pick that one forward. I mean, the point I would make is it's a shared puzzle. We may all have some different people may have slightly different views as to what the actual outcome and solution is, but the puzzle is definitely shared. Okay. In terms of communication, I mean, these things, we do a couple of them every single term. We do from time to time survey you. We sometimes worry that we survey you too much from time to time about various matters. But yeah, it's one of the challenges of a school of our size is. If we were a much smaller school, it would be much, much easier to do this. We've got quite a large parent body spread across a large number of age groups as well. But certainly, I know Sarah looks always very closely with other people about good ways to communicate. This, I hope this isn't going to look like the deliberate kind of the politician who says, oh, my car is waiting as he runs out the side. The last thing I do want to say, and I do say this every time, and I mean it absolutely every single time, is just a massive thank you. We, myself and all of my colleagues, we know that you give us good challenge, and that's great, and that, you know, makes the school better by having good challenge. But we also know that we're all absolutely 100% embedded in, we believe in this place, we love this place, and we want it to be the absolute best it can be for your children, for people who work here, for you as families as well. So I just want to say that in the last 5 years or so, every so often along comes, you know, whatever, that, you know, what fresh hell is this? It's a perk song. I feel it personally, and I know my colleagues feel it personally, that sense fundamentally of deep, deep support that you've got for us and for the school. So I just want to finish by saying a gigantic thank you and a very, very heartfelt one as well. Thank you very much.
I'm going to